Hello, my name is Tom Dick. I'm a math professor and a math advisor for Texas Instruments. This short video is part of the TI and Focus AP Calculus series. We're going to look at using the TI Inspire to analyze functions from a table of data values. As an example, we'll use a problem we made up to be quite similar to those found on the 2020 AP exam. Let's get started. Here's our context. We have a particle moving vertically along the y-axis, and we know that its position is a twice differentiable function y of t. T is measured in seconds, y of t is measured in meters. We're looking at the time interval from 0 to 12, and we know the position of the particle at time t equal 12 is y of 12 equals negative 3. On this next page here, we've all got the table of values for time and y prime, which we've labeled time and y dir for y derivative. Our values of time that are given are 0, 2, 6, 8, 10, and 12. In the second column, we have the corresponding values for y prime of t for each of those values of t. Now, to get started, we're going to graph this data. But instead of using the function plot, we'll use a scatter plot. So I've gone to a graphs page, and I'm going to pull up the menu and go to graph entry edit. We usually use function in calculus, but we're going to go and use scatter plot since we have a table of data. For x, I'm going to enter the name of our time value list, and for y, we'll put in y dir for the y prime values. We plot our scatter plot, and it'll just plot those points, those ordered pairs. I started out with a kind of a standard window here. Not all the data pairs are shown. So let's go to the window settings and do zoom data, and then it makes the window appropriate for handling all of our ordered pairs. Now, I'm going to make a little bit of a change on the axes here in terms of the labeling. So let me activate the axis and look at its attributes. And the thing I want to do here is actually have more labels. So I'm going to pull up attributes. I'm going to go down to this third option here and ask for multiple labels. Now, they still don't show, and that's because my hash marks are so close together. So I'm going to change my window settings a little bit here, and I'm going to go and change the X scale to be a hash mark at each unit, 1, and on the Y scale, let's do every 2 units. I think that'll space things a little bit further apart, and we should see a lot more data labels come up, or rather axis labels. Now that looks very nice. Okay, now that we have our scatter plot, let's look at some of the questions we might ask. One of them would be, we don't have a value at time t equal 4, and we might ask, could we estimate the acceleration at time t equal 4? Now we have velocity values at time t equal 2 and t equal 6. So we'll do the best thing we can, and we'll approximate this by calculating the rate of change between those two y prime values. That'll give us an estimate of y double prime. So I need the slope of that line segment that connected up the data points from time t equal 2 to t equal 6. So I pulled up the coordinates, and I'm labeling the two points with their coordinates. And we just need to find a slope. Could do a quick calculation in our heads here. Let's see, the difference in y values would be negative 2 minus 8, that'd be negative 10, over a difference in t values of 6 minus 2 or 4. So we'd be looking at negative 10 over 4 for a slope. I'm going to the geometry menu and actually pulling up measurement of slope. And let's see if we get that. It says negative 2.5, I guess that is negative 10 over 4. And that's our approximation of the acceleration at time t equal 4. Now, we're also asked in this problem to look at the average acceleration over the entire time interval from 0 to 12. Well, that's again going to be a slope of a line segment connecting a couple of points on this scatter plot. So let me again pull up the line segment tool, and I'm going to connect up 0, 4 to 12, negative 5. And now to get the average acceleration, we want the slope of that line segment. So I'm going to again pull up the coordinates and look at those first and last points in our time interval. And there's our 0, 4. And over here we've got 12, negative 5. And again, we're looking for the slope. Could do a calculation in our heads. Let's see, negative 5 minus 4 would be negative 9 over 12 minus 0. So negative 9 over 12, or negative 3/4. I'm going to go ahead and measure the slope of that line segment using the geometry tool. We're looking for negative 3/4, and there we go, negative 0.75. All right, let's go ahead to another question, this one involving an integral, or I should say an approximation of an integral. So I've cleaned up our graph. We got our original scatter plot again, and we're asked to use a midpoint Riemann sum with three subintervals of equal length. So that'd be from 0 to 4, 4 to 8, and 8 to 12. Now I'm going to go and pull up a grid. Let's use a line grid that corresponds to our hash marks on our axes. And we're going to go back to the geometry menu, and this time we're going to pull up shapes of rectangles to visualize this midpoint Riemann sum. So from the interval from 0 to 4, we'll use the value at t equal 2, which was 8. So I'm making a rectangle that sits on that interval from 0 to 4 with a height of 8. And from 4 to 8, I've got a rectangle that extends down to a height, in quotes, negative 2. And finally, from 8 to 12, our rectangle again is below the horizontal axis, height of negative 1. Our total Riemann sum now would be the total of the signed areas of these rectangles. We have 8 times 4, positive 32 here. This would be 4 times negative 2, or negative 8, and 4 times negative 1. I think for a grand total of 32 minus 12, or 20. So there's our midpoint Riemann sum estimate. A final question had to do with how many times, or showed that the velocity would have to be equal to 0 at least 3 times. Now I'm going to go to the geometry menu and pull up the segment tool again. And the main thing I'm going to do is just connect the dots in our scatter plot. So I'm connecting the first of 0, 4 to 2, 8, and then connecting to the point at t equals 6, and then our last line saying, oh, these last two lined up. So I get a kind of piecewise linear graph here. Now I want to stress that we know that y is twice differentiable. That means y prime is differentiable, and it would not have sharp corners in its graph. But it would be continuous because it's differentiable. And because it changes sign 3 times, it would have to also be equal to 0 at least 3 times. So that answers that question. Well, that winds up this short video. For more resources like these, please see education.ti.com.